welcome everyone. I imagine everyone is kind of bleary-eyed from last night's partying after the Bucks won a championship. So it's good to see all five or six of you here this morning, bright and early on a Wednesday morning this summer. The rest of it is our team. So I'm going to have just a conversation with our team, and I decided to just continue to wear the shirt that we got last night at the game because it was such a historic win. So if you take a look at that, that's what a championship does after 50 years. We didn't go to sleep. I just decided to put a jacket on this morning after partying all night. I'm just kidding. We partied all night till we got home at 11:40 and then talked to a couple of friends, went to bed at midnight. But it was wonderful. Great to see culmination of a lot of hard work. And it just reminds me of, I think, preparation. Anyway, I want to welcome you all to our bi-weekly webinar. We have a couple of different subjects today. I'll be bringing Ryan on for housekeeping, Ken for planning, and we'll have Zach doing some market ideas. And I'll just blather about with certain ideas that may jump in and make sense and may not. But that's my normal role here as well, trying to add perspective or at least sound like I'm cohesive. Just kidding. To many of you, I appreciate your time this morning. And what I'd like to do is go big before we jump into housekeeping. So my gratitude is hard work, 29 years worth or 27 years worth of season tickets and watching the Bucks kind of ascend to the pinnacle of the NBA. Again, it's just one part of life. It's great to celebrate. It's fun to do. It really gave 81,000 people downtown last night. Was pretty amazing to see a Super Bowl sized crowd all around the what I call the Pfizer Forum. I still call it the Bradley Center downtown. Really amazing to see, just to feel the vibe of that. And people from all over the nation reaching out on text and others. I sat right next to one of the owners and he had come in from New York with his daughter and four or five other people. It was really a magic moment as well. So we chose experience over selling our tickets for money. And we're glad we did, because the tickets cost to us was not as nearly as high as what some people are saying that it could have been, that we could have sold them for. So one of the big things that we wanted to make sure we told our girls, and we gave them the choice, they decided to for the experience as well, because it's probably potentially once in a lifetime. So my gratitude is just a great experience. How about Ken, yourself?
Yeah, I'll echo that. I was at home with the kids on the couch and my wife as well, and we were watching the game. And, you know, I said, hey, guys, remember this, because, like, you're part of history right now. You know, it's taken them 50 years, and it's taken my whole life, basically, to get where they are right now. And they get to experience it 8 years and 10 years into their life, which is pretty cool. So they got to stay up super late as well. My other gratitude is, you know, the Bucks is one thing. You guys have inspired me, clients on the call right now. You guys have inspired me for camping. I can't tell me how many camping stories I've heard over the last, you know, 5 or 6 years of getting to know you, and even longer if we've been working together longer than that. But we had a chance to go to Governor's Dodge this last weekend with the family. Wonderful area, wonderful place to hike around, wonderful beaches there. So what a great experience at Governor's Dodge. I know a lot of you have been there. You've told me about it. That's why we went there. So I just want to say thank you for inspiring me to get out there, set the camp up, and have a great time with the family. So thank you guys very much.
Awesome. Thank you, Ken. How about yourself, Zach?
Yeah, thank you, Chris. Extremely grateful for the Bucks as well. And without repeating kind of the other side of the gratitude of the Bucks, is the journey of the entire season, just COVID in general, all the way into the playoffs, kind of the adversity that the team went through, but really also just the experience of watching every one of the games with friends in some form, either at the games or talking to family about it, and really just a uniting thing for friends, family, and also the city of Milwaukee. It was really, really fun to watch and witness the journey.
I agree as well. I agree. It was fun. It was great to see. Well, thank you very much, guys. To many of you who watched or didn't watch or found it important or not important, it was a wonderful moment for Milwaukee sports, first championship in Milwaukee in 50 years. That was a good one. We've had championships in Green Bay, but that's not Milwaukee. That's just Wisconsin. That's what somebody said. I thought that was an interesting take on it as well. Sometimes that perspective is great. If you really want to hear a humble person, look at some of the post-game interviews and pre-game interviews of Giannis Antetokounmpo, our 26-year-old sage, who basically 8 years ago, his mother was on the streets selling trinkets to support the family as he was drafted in the NBA from Greece. So it's a very, very interesting story. Great story. It'll be made into a big documentary someday, I think. But the cool thing is that he's chosen Milwaukee. We've chosen him. It's a wonderful symbiotic relationship of entertainment. So we appreciate that one as well. What I wanted to do today, too, is I know that I've been given a gift by somebody here in the office, not to really mention any names, but it rhymes with Hack. And Zach, actually give us this book. I just want to ask you, I just wanted to say something here. We have bunnies, and our kids were extremely, extremely upset when our bunnies escaped. They're super concerned with hair loss. As I get older, I kind of get the same thing as well. So I thought that would be a good one. Anyway, I just wanted to run through that one before I pass it over to Ryan for some of the wonderful housekeeping, some of the important things going on. Ryan, what's going on?
Thanks, Chris. I also wanted to share, I've never seen my wife more excited at a sporting event than last night watching the Bucks win. It was a big thing for her and her family, having grown up in the area and, like yourself, lived through some years of the Bucks not being so good. So her and her family were very excited, and it was awesome to get to share that with them. As for the housekeeping, today we have our professional development day here in the office. So we will have some limited office availability, but we'll be checking messages and emails for anything, any urgent matters to be able to get back to you throughout the day. We have tomorrow our health and wealth webinar with Michelle Norris once again. So, be sure to RSVP for that. That's in your email folders as well. Tomorrow, the topic will be decreasing inflammation and eating what's in season. So very awesome topics for summertime. Then we also have our next biweekly webinar will be Wednesday, August 4th. So make sure you're watching your emails to RSVP for that as well. August 7th, we have sponsored the Music in the Park event. So there will be music playing down at Fiendsville Village Park from 12:30 p.m. all the way till 9 p.m. Of course, some intermittent little breaks in there, but lots of fun stuff going on down in the park again, similar to the event we had about a month ago. Thursday, August 26th, then, is our next Ladies and Gentian event. Details to come. So that's another one to watch your email boxes for. And also wanted to just have a quick reminder that Michelle Norris, who is presenting for that health and wealth event, you can always email her questions about nutrition and such. That email address is in the email as well, but that's michelle@sweatnet.com. That's what I got for housekeeping today, Chris.
Fabulous, fabulous. I appreciate that. Thank you very much. A lot going on. I hope you guys are having a great summer as well. Some of the ideas and some of the things going on people's top of mind right now, some of the hot topics are different variants coming into America. Somebody made an interesting observation with half of the country vaccinated, maybe another 30 or 40% actually having COVID. How big can the next spike be? It was a great question. I don't know the answer, but some people have actually have asked that same question, and something to look forward on an interesting basis. The market had a jolting day just the other day, down a couple percentage points. And then the next day recovered pretty decently as well. There's still a lot of capital, a lot of free money out there. So regardless of this, there's a delay in this, in the recovery because of another COVID. I think we're learning to live with it, which is really interesting from what I've seen with 81,000 people downtown. People are definitely learning to live with it. But again, it's still a serious issue. And I think for those who are most at risk, just be careful with that. So we appreciate what your opinion is in keeping us abreast of your health and your situation as well. Some other things going on. Obviously, it's been a wonderful summer. The markets have been doing very well. People keep saying, hey, Chris, there's going to be a correction. My answer, of course, is, yeah, there will be. The difference is, I don't know when. You may think that you do. The key is, we know that'll happen. It's inevitable. It's part of what markets are. So again, it's a long road to the bumpy ride on it as well. So we want to be careful with that. Another couple things as well, you know, we've kind of dropped some of the meme stocks, the cryptocurrency. Some people think the speculation is coming out of the market. Some people think there's a lot of speculation in the market. What they don't realize is with like $17 trillion or some huge number like that, according to JP Morgan, in cash sitting on the sidelines getting zero, there's plenty of fuel for the fire. Kind of like the, you know, unfortunate wildfires out west. I mean, this is a summer to reflect on what's going on. There's some massive fires out west. We're seeing drought. We're seeing all sorts of things. But really, I think it's a wonderful, wonderful time to say, what are we fortunate for? What are we blessed for? What can we be appreciative of as well? Because what I've noticed is if the world drags me, Chris Doty, into that negativity, it still can. But I fight and work like crazy to get out of that and come back to what's positive. And I'll tell you what, when I start with positive focus and going big, it makes a huge difference in how both meetings go and just how my day goes. So this morning, I saw Ken this morning at the stairs. And it was a beautiful, beautiful morning. Flowers are out everywhere. Yeah, it's just a gorgeous morning. You had a beautiful sunrise, and you just focus on what you've got that you're blessed for. So we think it's a very important one as well. You know, another couple of topics that you'll find out that today, what are happening with tax laws? What about the new budget? What about the things? There's a lot of those things coming, but they're not yet defined. When they're defined, we'll let you know. Another thing we have coming to you is our mid-year letter. It's a chance for us to restate our timeless principles of what we do. A little bit later on, I'll read some of that to you as well. I won't blather on about it now. What I'll probably do is I'll probably go to first to Zach, and then I'll probably go to Ken, and then I'll read some of the different timeless pieces that we have. And you're going to get this in letter format coming up here as well over the next week or so. But anyway, I just wanted to introduce you a couple of those. There's other topics coming up. There's some planning topics, some of the old reiterative things that we want to talk about as well. But we've had a lot of people lately looking to plan retirement who you would think already have. So those people you've introduced to us, we want to thank you for. We've been very blessed lately. We have great, great people you've introduced us to. We still have capacity for some. So please continue to introduce us. And what we're finding is the interesting piece, those people who you would think have had a plan, don't. I read something recently about 85% of people who are selling something, or 85% of people in the position to believe to retire, they believe, do not have an overarching plan. That is critical. So we'll bring that up with Ken a little bit later, and Ken will answer every question we've ever had about planning. So that'll be good. With that, though, I want to pass it over to Zach DeBoer. He's got some wonderful insight. You know, he's, again, I think I've said this before, he's the oldest member of our team, not so much by age, but maybe by how he acts and how he presents himself, which is quite funny. I'll forever remain a kid. I know Ken is probably younger than I am as a kid as well, but Zach is probably the most mature of the three of us anyway. So I will pass it over to Zach. Zach, you can take it over.
Well, I appreciate it. Thank you, Chris. And forgot to mention during my Go Big that I got my lucky Bucks tie on today too. So didn't wear the Giannis jersey, but still have the tie on. But as far as the markets go, the S&P 500 year to date is still at 15.10%. Like Chris mentioned, had some volatility earlier this week, and the media made it feel like it was a very large correction. And the S&P 500 is actually only up less than, or is 0.46 off, a little bit lower than 2 weeks ago. So very close to where it was. The Dow Jones, 12.76% year to date. And the top headline after Monday was Dow tumbles more than 700 points. If you've been watching webinars and seeing what we've talked about in the past, is they leave out percentages because the points have gotten much larger, which 700 points is now a 2% movement, which is completely normal. And we see many, many times throughout the year. The NASDAQ, which is more heavily weighted towards technology, 12.50%. One of the biggest moves in the last 2 weeks that we've seen was in the small cap space. The Russell 2000 is still up 11.11% on the year. Growth 3.40, and value of small caps still up 19.33. But each of those are off 4% from 2 weeks ago. So that was probably where the biggest movement was here within the last couple of weeks. The international, measured by the MSCI, excluding USA, 5.04%. And then emerging markets, still lagging a little bit behind compared to the others, 1.40%. So a great reason to stay diversified, stay in emerging markets. What happens oftentimes, they see, oh, emerging markets only up 1.40. I'm going to move out of there and move into something that's doing well, which is a critical mistake that investors make. Another really interesting note was that real estate, as of market close yesterday, is up 27.14% year to date, which is now the best performing sector year to date. And if you remember last year and from all of our conversations, which I'm sure you do, real estate was actually the worst performing sector last year. So within a 1 year time frame, the worst performing sector became the best. Just another great example to stay diversified. On the fixed income side of things, the 1 year treasury is 0.08% current yield, the 5 year 0.78%, 10 year 1.30%, and the 30 year 1.93%. So each of those are slight decreases from 2 weeks ago when we took a look at that. Just a important note that we wanted to talk about, and Chris mentioned it as well, is the world and the market is always going to give us something to be concerned about or fearful of, whether it's the new variant or earnings beat, but it wasn't as much as it was, or forecasts are lower than expected, even though revenues look great this quarter. We never know what the future is going to hold, but the most important thing is to keep perspective and focused on that long-term plan, exactly as Chris mentioned.
Fabulous, Zach. Thank you very much. Isn't it interesting, though? It seems like people always say, hey, hold on to emerging markets. It's really been under the table for 8 years and it's really been underneath. And also, I've had a lot of people bring up, Zach, the idea of real estate. Isn't real estate going to be horrible to own in COVID now that people aren't going to have to go back to work? And it's interesting. Real estate encompasses a lot more than just offices that you believe. Real estate goes from it's a gambit from warehouses to shopping centers to new urban centers that people are living in. Like, oh, right here, actually, in Mequon, we've got something called Foxtown and Spur 16. It's about 400 apartment units that are luxury apartments. And I was really surprised thinking, oh, how are they going to fill up 400? Now they're wondering how they can build more. So they're looking at more capacity. Mequon's becoming kind of a little hamlet of retiree and affluent retirees with lots of activities for them and all. It's really interesting to watch. So thank you, Zach, on that. That's really awesome perspective. And there's so much I can do when Zach brings those kind of things up. I can always hop in and give a bunch of stuff on it, but I'm gonna be careful on it because I don't want to continue to just harp on one or two different things. So thank you tremendously. So between myself and Ken, what I want to do real quick here, though, is I've got a gentleman named Dan Sullivan that I like to that I talk with, and I had a strategic coach just recently, and he said he sent something called What's on His Mind, but we just talked about this pretty heavily in our strategic coach meeting on Thursday last week. We spent 6 hours talking together. But he talked about the process of what he can do right now for longevity that are simple and accessible, like eating and sleeping well. There are five conditions that he believes also benefit the extension of physical life. He thinks it's an important thing for him. One, always have an increasing quality and quantity of friends so you're never lonely or the only one left. Interesting, right? Number two, believe that there's always enough money to fund your biggest goals. Working with us to make sure we know what your goals are. But he's saying your career may not end when you think it does. You may have a second career to fund some of your bigger goals. Know that the purpose of your future is more significant than anything you've achieved in your past. Number four, constantly increase the level of enjoyable novelty in your life. It benefits and stimulates your brain and forces you to adapt. So you have to look up what is novelty. Learning piano, doing something new. I got to tell you, as you get older, you don't want to do things you knew. You want to do things that you know well. I always do things that maybe I'm uncomfortable with, and what you'll find is, wow, that's kind of fun. Hey, let's go water ski. Maybe that's not the greatest example, but for me, it's getting near edges and I've got a bit of vertigo, but if I can adjust to it, I absolutely love it, but it takes me a bit to do it as well. Learning piano might be a little bit easier, however. The last one is be proud of who you used to be and don't try to escape your past. It's a platform from which to build extraordinary things. So he says this, it's kind of funny. You can create a much bigger future for yourself with a longevity mindset. It's a mindset again. If you believe you'll live long, don't do tombstone talk. Oh, I'm so old now. Oh, I can't do that. Be careful of that because a lot of your friends will lead you into that. Be careful with those friends or spouses or others that you know. Like, Dad, you should really retire. You should retire. Well, who says you should retire? If you love what you're doing, do it. Another one, this is why he's committed to his daily motto. Today, I'm going to give death no assistance. I thought that was a good one. Today, I'm going to give death no assistance. So waking up every day thinking that, it's kind of a negative way to think about it, but it was an interesting one for him. Anyway, great mindsets. I just thought I'd share before I hop into Ken. Ken, how about yourself? Why don't you give us some planning? Show us how what we can do. What kind of questions can you answer for us so we can have all this money when we retire and live super long?
Yeah, it's a good point, Chris. And I'll talk about that a little bit today as well. But first of all, you mentioned water skiing. You want to push yourself in water ski. I would be happy to rent that boat and also pull you while you water ski. I think that would be a very, very enjoyable exercise that we could do together. That's almost like team building. Don't you guys think the team building exercise there?
I think so, but Ken, I've seen you drive a supercar. I'm not so sure I want you driving the boat.
I do like to go to 0 to 80 pretty quickly, don't I? So
yeah, that's funny.
Absolutely. So here's some planning ideas that I would like to bring to your attention. We've talked about the 4% rule in meetings. We've talked about the 4% rule on calls like this and Zoom calls like this. Really, the 4% rule, if you haven't heard it before, is if you take a look at your overall assets and you times that by 4%, that is the amount of annual income that you could reasonably expect to spend in retirement and not have to worry about running out of money. That's been proven through studies, through and through. So when you look at that, now just be careful a little bit on that because, account balances typically, I'm using a broad brush right now to say this, typically have never been higher. Okay. So again, you're using 4% on a bigger number right now. Well, we all know, like Chris mentioned before, is there a market correction coming at some point in time? The answer is yes. And so $1 million can become $800,000. So 4% on $800,000 is less than 4% on $1 million for income. So just keep that in mind, because it does play into the planning and how we structure your portfolio, how we structure the income for you guys as well. Another piece that has come up quite a bit in meetings is the idea of creating experiences for families. Okay. Now, again, times are good right now. So if there's that one thing that you really wanted to do for the family and you wanted to create an experience or something annually that you do, now is a good time to do that if you have wiggle room in that 4% number. Some of you are only taking out 2% on an annual basis, so you have wiggle room. Right now is a great time to do something like that. Now, on the flip side of that, when your account value is not in favor temporarily or the markets are down temporarily, you know, and you say, hey, you know, is there a little wiggle room? We're going to say, can it wait? And so, you know, it's always a tough conversation, but our job is to make sure that you don't run out of money in your 25 to 35 to 45 year retirement potentially. That's our number one commitment to you guys. So again, these are conversations that we have during our meetings. And so I wanted to bring those to your attention. The other part is electric vehicles. We see them all around. They're becoming more and more, you know, common, if you will. There's actually a pretty huge tax credits that go along with potentially buying certain electric vehicles that are out there. So I learned this one from an accountant the other day, one of our great partners. And really, if there is a tax credit and it's very substantial, you also need to have the tax liability to offset the tax credit. Otherwise, you just lose the tax credit, okay? So in our minds, that's bad planning because you're really wasting money that you really could be using for yourself and putting more money into your pocket or into your portfolio. So there's a couple ideas that go along with that, creating income, believe it or not, taxable income through Roth conversion planning to offset these tax credit ideas. Again, it's not necessarily a one-off situation, but it's becoming more and more popular as electric vehicles become more and more popular. So again, we're on the forefront of this. Happy to help you through that. Happy to work with you or your accountant and give you some of these ideas that we know about. Lastly is a very misleading topic. I think that the insurance industry has given policy holders, if you will. So if you own an insurance policy, and it's, say it's a whole life or a variable universal life or anything that has some cash value to it. Now, when you look at your statements, you're going to see that you have a face value or the amount of insurance that you have. Let's just say, for example, is $100,000. Okay. But down the line, you may see your cash value be at $35,000. Well, a lot of people think that you get both. So if something happens to that person, a lot of people think it's $135,000 in this example, right? $100,000 of insurance, $35,000 of the cash value, and you get both. That's actually not the case. You get one or the other. And so as you own these policies for a longer period of time, you bought them back in the 80s and the 70s when you had families and the kids were young and things of that nature. Now you own these things. Now what do we do with them? Bring them up to us. Show us what you have. There's ways to optimize these dollars inside of these policies. Sometimes we keep the policies. Sometimes we leverage it in a different way to really optimize your money. So just wanted to bring that to your attention because these are some of the things that we're seeing pretty consistently right now in meetings. And I want to make sure everyone is aware of those. So with that being said, I'm going to go rent a boat and I'm going to pull Chris behind it water skiing. Have a great day, everybody.
And I think one of our great attendees today, Kurt, had actually said, hey, Chris, I'd pull you anytime and maybe even barefoot. So he might have jumped the gun and he offered beforehand. So
All right, Kurt, I'll go second. That's fine.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe he'll pull both of it at the same time. We can do some ski wars or something like that. So you can knock each other over at jousting or something. Again, thank you, Ken. Love the perspective. I think it's wonderful to see. I think, you know, a lot of times life insurance is part of the bigger picture. People don't know what to do. They get it when they're younger and they orphan it when they get later on. They don't know what to do. They surrender it. So there's a lot of really interesting things you can do, even things which are life settlements, which are at the end of life, selling the policy to a viatical settlement group who will buy the policy from you rather than just let it lapse. So there's people out there that make entire careers on doing things like that. So some of those ideas are out there. Just bring it to us. We aren't the experts, but we have experts that we have on in our reach and our team and staff that can do that as well. So we just can recognize what might be an opportunity and maybe help you with that. So thanks, Ken. I appreciate that. So one thing I want to do as well, and this is kind of an interesting one, you know, I think we've always talked about this. We're really quite affluent. We're fairly fortunate. I was talking recently with somebody, and we kind of came up with the idea, do you think our kids are spoiled, they asked. And I said, no, I think they all smell like that. So at any rate, I thought that was a pretty good one. As we went through, I know you guys thought I was going down a serious line. We'll talk about the spoiling of our kids later, because a lot of us do that. And as grandparents, that is your role, is to spoil your kids for, spoil your grandkids for your kids to have to deal with. So that's often kind of fun. As I promised, I wanted to do a couple things. One summary of Dan Sullivan. We spent, 6 hours talking with some of the best entrepreneurs in America. It was awesome. We really had a great time. But actually, if I try to summarize the whole thing into one little statement, so I've got a whole bunch of things. Dan's talking about freedom of time, money, freedom of relationship, freedom of purpose. He really believes also Zoom is probably the single biggest capability that has come out of the pandemic. And he gives us great books like Zooming Ahead, bless you, Ken. And with that, these are some of the kind of things, if you really wanted a book like this, you can request it, we can put your name in and he can get it. But these are interesting. He really thinks this is the biggest single capability, because he says, you're here, they're there, and we're together. He can now leverage his time anywhere in the world with any group he'd like to. He doesn't have to fly to New Zealand to do a program in New Zealand. It was really an interesting statement, but he thinks that's the single biggest capability picked up in this pandemic, which is interesting. But here, we go through several other pieces as well, but one of the most important things we've learned when we really boil all of this 6 hours down to one thing is, do you know what successful people typically do? They do something. You know what most people do? They have ideas and they put it in a parking lot that they never come back to. Successful people do something about it. You might've had that idea. You see, this would be great if they did this. And then 2-3 years later, somebody makes it or does it and does really well, or actually doesn't do well with it. But the whole point is they successful people often do something. A couple of things I want to do with our mid-year letter. As America kind of can recovers, if you will, and still roils a little bit in the COVID-19 pandemic in the first half of 2021, the economy and equity markets really made significant progress, even employment as well. But the mid-year report we have is divided into two parts, our general principles, and really look at the second as kind of our perspective. I won't read the perspective because we give that quite a bit of time, and you'll get that in the newsletter. But our general principles, remember, you and I are long-term, goal-focused, planning-driven equity investors. We've found that the best course for us to formulate a financial plan and to build portfolios based not on a view of the economy or the markets, but on our most important lifetime financial goals, that's financial planning. Since 1960, the S&P index has appreciated approximately 70 times. The cash dividend of the index has gone up about 30 times. Over the same period, the consumer price index, or CPI, has gone up by a factor of 9. That's 70, 30, and 9 times, those three across the board. At least historically then, mainstream equities have functioned as an extremely efficient hedge against the long-term inflation as a generator of real wealth over time. We believe this is more likely than not to continue in the long run, hence our investment policy of owning successful companies rather than lending to them, which would be bonds. We believe that acting continuous on the rational plan as a distinctly opposed to reacting to current events offers us the best chance for long-term investment success. Simply stated, unless our goals change, we see little reason to alter our financial plan. And if our portfolio is well-suited, we believe that the economy, If our portfolio is well-suited to the plan, we don't often make significant changes to that either. We do believe the economy can, we do not believe the economy can be consistently, what's called forecast or guessed. We think it's super important. The markets also cannot be consistently timed. We're therefore convinced that the most reliable way to capture the long-term return of equities is to ride out their frequently, but ultimately temporary downturns. The performance of our equity portfolio relative to their benchmarks is irrelevant to the investment success as we define it. It is also a variable over which we ultimately have no control. We can't control markets, we know. The only benchmark we care about is the one that indicates whether you are on track to achieve your financial goals. We appreciate when you share those with us, when you really get deep and say, these are some of the things I really want to accomplish, and we can help you decide whether those are actually going to happen or not. But stating these is important every 6 months or so, just I think because the world takes us away from what those goals are. It's planning, it's consistency, and it's focus. It's what really the Bucks did, if you will. If you talk to Giannis 8 or 9 years ago, he committed to working hard. Now, working hard didn't get him there. He has natural talent as well. But this recipe for success, all put together, really made a big difference. The same thing happens with your plan. What do you want to do? How do you want to do it? Let's put a plan together for it. And then more importantly, let's have the discipline, faith, and patience to execute it. So there'll be more that's coming on the current economy and the observations as well. But I really wanted to show some of those or share some of those timeless principles because it's always good every 6 months or so for us to do so. I want you to be able to recite it in your sleep. I had a hard time reciting it, even though I wrote it here, just because I think it's a day after a big win and maybe slightly lack of sleep. But I really appreciate those. And I want to make sure you understand the older I get, the more perspective I have, the more groups I'm in, the more I learn from other people. It gets more and more simple, meaning that wisdom is taking the complex and stating it in a simple way. What we want to do is to make sure we help you understand what that is and how you can attain that as well. So in a very simple way, we want to explain things, but if you want to know some of the detail behind it, ask us, we can talk about that. So thank you for bringing up all the concerns you have and feel free to bring them up. We appreciate them, we celebrate them, and we're here to help you with those. So I really appreciate that as well. Ken, Zach, anything else you guys have to say before I sign off?
Have a great rest of your summer, everybody. We look forward to seeing you in the office and enjoy time with your family and friends and get out there and experience life. Have a great time.
Absolutely. And one of the things we say too is go out and reach out to somebody who maybe isn't doing so well or coming back into the economy or coming back into their social life. Maybe reach out to them, see if there's anything you can do for them. I tend to find there's two things. One, when you go do something for someone, and number two is when you ask for help, you're giving somebody a chance to do something for you. Those are two of the times I feel actually the best. So we appreciate that. We appreciate your focus with us. Most importantly, you know, we're here to help you plan, live, and give during retirement. So remember, Argentine retirement is plan it, live it, and give it. We completely appreciate you, what you do, the introductions you give to us, the questions you have. I really want to make sure that you guys understand as well. You can reach out to us anytime. Most importantly, go out and have a absolutely wonderful next 2 weeks. We will see you again August 4th, I think it is, if I've said that correctly. It's 2 weeks Wednesday. Have a great one.